Stellar and Dove Award winner Brian Courtney Wilson chats with me about the inspiration behind some of his greatest songs, social justice, mental illness, and so much more. Welcome to The Conversation with Brian Courtney Wilson.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Brian Courtney Wilson, thank you for being a part of the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
So grateful. I was just had the opportunity to chat with you, and I told you that I was totally a fan of your ministry and your call and your gift. So thank you for what you contribute to our world and to the kingdom.
Thank you for saying so, and I appreciate you having me on. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I know who you are. I've been following you for years. Tell us in your words, who is Brian Courtney Wilson?
I'm a singer, songwriter, father, family man, black man in America.
right.
Huge basketball fan.
Okay.
A proud parent. I'm a whole, you know, whole lot of stuff.
Yeah.
I appreciate the question because you know, it's easy for people to make assumptions about who you are based on what they're able to access about you. Mm-hmm. But I'm a lot of stuff, you know, so I think I appreciate you asking the question.
Now, I have to ask you this. My nephew and I were just talking about basketball and Giannis. Who is your favorite basketball team? And then we're going to get to this real interview.
My favorite team? Oh, that's a tough question. I live in Houston, so I really dig Houston, the Rockets, you know, just being in Houston. I grew up in Chicago, so I have an affection for the Bulls because I was around when Jordan was winning those six championships in Chicago. So I have an affection for them. So probably between those two.
Right.
And, you know, I dig Steph Curry. I wouldn't say I was a Golden State Warrior fan, but I like his vibe.
Yeah.
I like what Giannis is doing. I love basketball, to be honest.
Period.
I see so many parallels between basketball and life.
Yeah.
And there's a music to it when I watch it.
Oh, that's
I would
good.
Consider those guys I name, you know, just great musicians
in
that regard.
I love it. Oh, you were a part of the 90s, the Chicago Bulls 90s.
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh.
No question. Yep.
Now, I am so grateful to have you on this podcast because we're going to, of course, talk about your new music. But there's such a parallel line with what's going on in our country today with the social injustice, the movement. And you did something that is just shaking up gospel music. You re-recorded Marvin Gaye's song.
Yeah, Inner City Blues.
Inner City Blues. And you sound like him. It's just beautiful. That song is as relevant now as it was 50 years ago. Can you speak to that? What inspired you to re-record that?
Well, I certainly wasn't. I'll say this. We were doing a tribute record for Motown because they were celebrating their anniversary. I think it was I can't even remember how. I think it was 60 years of Motown.
Okay.
And so this was just going to be a part of your tribute record. I had no intention of releasing it widely.
Wow.
And then just given the time, especially when we watched George Floyd get murdered on TV.
Yeah.
I thought this was something we needed to say for the very reason you stated. The words, although the song is 50 years old now, are relevant today.
Mm-hmm.
And in a way, it's lamentable, but necessary, I think, to say it again. And I wasn't trying to shake up gospel music or anything. You know, I just wanted to, I always try to just do what's in my heart, what I'm afforded the opportunity to do, and be consistent with my audience. And so prayerfully, they receive it well, it's an entry point to the other things I'd like to say in ministry.
Yeah, I'm a fan. I listen to it over and over. And you did shake up gospel music. I'll just tell you in a good way, though. I mean, it's one of those songs that it helps you understand what's going on, and it helps you connect rather than just seeing it on TV, but connect through music.
Well, I appreciate that. Listen, we got to honor the courage of Marvin Gaye to do it at the time.
Yeah.
One of the reasons he was able to do it is because he was the darling of his label at the time. So he hadn't been doing songs like that. But he felt, given the presence of the Vietnam War, that he had to say something.
Yep.
And his label resisted it because they did not think songs about protest and struggle would sell.
Okay.
And I actually see parallels, not in the selling part, but just in when I think about some of the things we talk about in Christendom, how sometimes we are discouraged from protest. Sure. We're discouraged from speaking to social ills, and we should just preach the gospel. One of the things I wanted to say was, I see them as inextricably tied. If we're going to talk about the gospel and good news, we got to talk about, well, what's the bad news? Where are the blues at? Where do we show up with this good news? So that is what part of this song is about.
Yeah. And I wanted to say with that song and with many of your songs, it's like your songs speak to the current condition of our world. I mean, when I go back to Fighting For, which is still just an anthem in our homes, and your current projects, it's like you sense, and I know it's the guy in you, what's going on in our country, and you inspire us. And that song is so inspirational. So I'll ask, where do you get your inspiration from to write and sing songs that speaks directly to people's current conditions?
Typically, I'm starting with myself and then my family.
Come on.
And then I think about the people that reared me. I think about my church, the churches that, again, I use this word, afforded me the grace to present it at their spots. What would minister to them?
Yeah.
So those are the things that are inspiring me. I, in particular, you brought up We're Fighting For. I was thinking about my career at the time, and it was at a crossroads, and I was trying to decide whether it was something we were going to keep moving forward with and what that would look like.
Yeah.
And it was a declaration that the faith it would take to keep moving forward would be worth investing.
My God.
When I think about a great work, literally, I was thinking about the churches responding to that event. God is doing a great work. I could see that. And that was my prayer. But there's no guarantee that people will connect with it. So it's always by faith. But that's usually the inspiration. I want the music to be useful. That's what I'm always thinking.
Awesome. And it starts with you. And you can tell that. It starts with you. It's something that you personally experience, and then you share with us. So thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
Seriously. Now, you have Breathe Again in conversations with Brian Courtney Wilson on Instagram, correct?
We're starting that Thursday, tonight, actually.
And you're,
I'm not sure when this is going to air. I'm going to start it tonight.
You know what? We're going to make sure that this airs soon.
Okay.
Tell you, okay, this is what I love. You church, your God, your kingdom. But you are talking about self-esteem, mental illness, which some people don't like to touch. Some Christians think it's taboo. What has pushed you to say, you know what, I'm going to cover these topics?
When I think about ministry, it always comes down to meeting the need for me.
Oh.
And I see it as a need.
Mm,
in fact, one of the things we're going to be doing in conjunction with the city of Houston, and this is just after a conversation with a friend of mine that works on the committee.
Okay.
Something in my spirit said, hey, call and see if they will have you down for lunch, in a socially distanced lunch, and let you come sing. I call, and she says, you know what, I got something better for you. We're doing a town hall on mental health and the inequities in our community. Would you be willing to share in the town hall?
Mm-hmm.
And the presence of that type of need, because she said, man, we see it. It's not just about the pandemic. It's about the way it's affecting our minds and the stress it's causing everyone. Yeah. And so that's a need. And I felt it myself. The things I've had to reckon with over the last couple of years in terms of anxiety and connecting that to breathing properly and connecting that to singing properly.
Okay.
Connecting that to visioning out in a way where you can plan and do what God has called you to do.
Yeah.
And it comes back to, I can't escape the role of mental health in that.
So
you're the second person that says a lot of people don't want to talk about it. And it, to me, I hear it, but maybe that's just in my sphere of influence.
Okay.
The people I know,
gotcha.
They're comfortable talking about it. I'm speaking to a good friend tonight. Her name is Pastor Juanita Rasmus. She has a book called Learning to Be. And I just think her story is beautiful in terms of the ability to bounce back, the ability to keep pressing forward even after, and these are her words, after you crash. How do you get up, pick up the pieces, and move forward and learn to be? And I think a lot of people struggle with that. A lot of people are afraid of that, of crashing.
That's it.
And I think we could address that. I think we got something to offer that could at least point you in the right direction.
Amen. So what can we look forward to on these Thursday nights?
I call it a song and a sit down. And this is, you know, I'm not an interviewer like a Charlie Rose type dude. I'm not any of that. I hear something in my spirit and I think we're going to try it.
So, okay. You
know, try and sing a song, set an atmosphere. And I called Pastor Juanita because I trust her. I know she has a heart for healing and compassion. And it's evidenced out in the church that they lead and the way they feed the homeless and minister to people that are dealing with these things in their mind, their heart, their spirit. And I've seen it over and over again and serve with them in that regard. So I'm looking forward to her sharing in the way that God allows tonight.
That's so good. And you said something that resonated with me. You said you're doing it because you see a need. So you're meeting a need. You're meeting a need.
Preferably. Hey, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. Go ahead.
I was going to say, one of the things I've seen, and I've seen this since Harvey hit Houston, is sometimes people are reluctant to help because they don't think they have enough to help. So they don't even ask, like, well, how could I help?
Okay.
Because they imagine that the problem was too big for them to offer something that could help. And I've seen where if you can just ask with a willing heart, even the little bit you have can be used. Okay. And I keep thinking about the story about the boy with the two fish and five loaves of bread. When the disciples said, man, we got to feed these people. They've been following us. Well, they got his fish, two fish, five loaves of bread. And I'm certain he did not bring that out there that day to feed all of the people.
Yep, you're right.
He was willing. He obeyed and put it in the master's hands. And now we have a miracle that we're discussing today. So that is part of what this is about for me, is just disciplining myself to be obedient when God says plant the seed.
Amen. Amen. And with your ministry, it touches so many through the song and now through the discussion. And with that being said, we need discussion. We, as a church, as ministries, there has to be discussion about mental health, about the movement. Where do you see the church in regards to meeting the need and helping in the midst of what's going on in our country today?
I think what great churches have always done is inspire, of course, and then distribute the right information so you can move forward. The great churches I know distribute information and resource in a way that can bring healing, in a way that can get you to what you need. So I think that's where I see the role of the church in doing that. Yes. And then we're supposed to be beacons of the truth, too.
Yeah.
So one of the things that I think messes with our mind is when we settle for delusion, like when we settle for images that are easily manipulated, and so they're not really the truth.
Yeah.
And so we're trying to navigate our way, and we really can't even see our way because of what we put in front of us. And I think the churches can play a role in dispelling those notions.
Yeah.
I heard Oswald Chambers call it disillusionment. And when you say disillusionment, a lot of times it has a negative connotation, but that's a good thing.
Come on.
It's when the illusion is lifted and now I can see clearly.
Yeah. So moving forward, the church is to inspire and help move people forward.
I believe so.
I believe so. I'm in total agreement with you. Now,
thank you.
With that, you have this new project that is going to help us move forward. I have to ask you, tell us about this new project, and can you sing us a little bit of something?
I don't know. Well, I can't say a whole lot about the project beyond okay. what we presented already. So Inner City Blues is the departure point for us.
Yay.
One of the things
it's okay, Saints. Can I interject here? It's okay, Saints, if you listen to Inner City Blues. It's okay. It's okay.
Well, my prayer is that it's part of a context. Even when I told the label that we were doing it, I said, okay, but I need to know that you guys are going to be with me to create context around it.
And I love
prayerfully,
it.
And thankfully, I have a team that's been gung-ho about doing that.
Okay.
But one of the things I want people to get from the song is that we don't just holler and we don't just settle for the blues. We holler and we're heard. And then for the people that have become accustomed to listening to me, you're holding on to the answer. The good news is the answer, right?
Hey,
so you need to be able to holler, know that you're heard, by a God who can do something about your situation.
Amen.
And usually has given you the answer.
Yeah.
You just have to walk it out. Walk it out. And even as I say it, Ms. Washington,
yeah.
I don't want to sound like I'm trying to thump people with the Bible.
Or it's cliche. Okay.
I know how, well, I don't know that it is okay, because for so many, there have been so many instances where that's been used to pacify people and used to keep people from wanting more. The history is rife with people using the Bible to get them to settle for the chains.
Wow.
And settle for the slavery, right? So that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that there's enough power to break free.
Yeah.
There's enough power to break free. And there's enough power to keep loving. There's enough power to plant seeds for moving mountains.
Yeah.
Moving mountains. And I believe we're in a position to do it. How else can I justify this gift of breath and life that I have that I did not earn?
Wow.
That I've already been shown favor with by God breathing it into me. There must be a reason I'm still here.
That's so awesome.
So that we're all still here.
Amen.
And that's what I want to speak to moving forward. So not these blues will not last always.
Ooh.
I just don't believe it.
Say that again. That's a blessing. These blues will not last always. Thank you for putting that in perspective. Thank you. Thank you.
I appreciate you asking. And actually, it's so funny. That's probably the first time I've been able to even articulate it as clear as I saw. You know what I'm saying? So I salute your anointing in that regard.
Oh, well, thank you so much. Thank you.
In fact, with that, I'm going to honor this moment because you asked. This is what I'm going to say. This won't be from the new stuff, but I'll say, eyes haven't seen. Is having heard all you have planned for me, and nothing can separate me from your love. And there's so much more still worth fighting for.
Love that song. Love that song. You probably have about 1,500 streams from my family alone.
I appreciate it.
It's so anointed. It's so amazing. I ask these two questions every time I end a podcast. My first question is, as we bring this to a close, you have been great. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you for having me.
My first question is always, besides God, who has influenced you the most?
My mother and father start.
Okay.
What I got from my mother was always this. She always clinged to the truth, you know, and even growing up sometimes, I remember her being, you know, when we did testimony services in church, we don't do that much now.
I know.
But I was like, yo, what is she about to say? Is she going to keep it real? You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It doesn't always look good for you. But she taught me to be comfortable with uncomfortable truths in my own life. She taught me that. And then my dad, just for his faithfulness, I watched him for years serve as a deacon in the Baptist church and work hard for his family. In fact, one of my songs is about remembering him at the kitchen table using what I was, I mean, he wasn't a rich man, but he got the roof over our head. He was in school. He gave us what I would consider a sheltered life because he stayed faithful. So he's a big inspiration to me as well.
Okay. And the next question is, what is one thing that you know for sure? At the end of the day, you're like, yep, I know that for sure.
Ooh, wow. That's so funny. Because I was thinking about Job the other day, and that was Job.
Job, my God.
And one of the things there were things that Job thought he knew for sure, and God was like, no, you weren't there when I hung the moon and the stars and I created this world. And so you are lamenting a reality that you really don't have a full perspective on. And so what I know for sure is that the more you know, the more you find out you don't know.
That's a good one. The more you know.
But I let love lead me. That's what I try to do every day. Love myself, love the people around me.
Yeah.
Set boundaries around myself. So if you're in my space and you're not assigned to me and you still don't love me, I know, hey man, I don't have no problem pushing back from that table.
That's good. You follow what I'm saying? Yep.
So I try to let love lead me, and I think I'm okay from the scripture where it says love covers a multitude of sins.
Praise.
So even if I don't know, the love can help me make it.
Thank you. That's beautiful. I am so grateful to have you, Mr. Brian Courtney Wilson. You are inspiration, and behind your singing, behind you writing songs, just listening to you speak is a blessing to us all. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. You've been so kind and gracious, and I look forward to seeing this continue to blossom for you. And I pray the same for my ministry too.
Thank you.
This has been a wonderful experience.
Thank you. Tell our audience, how can we get your music and how can we keep in touch with you via social media?
You can go to our Instagram page, Brian Courtney Wilson. You can go to Facebook, Brian Courtney Wilson. You can go to Twitter at B Courtney Wilson. The music is everywhere you stream music, and my website is briancourtneywilson.com.
All right. Thank you. Thank you to our audience, and we want to give a special thank you to Brian Courtney Wilson. Check out his new music, his re-record of Marvin Gaye's hit. Tell us the song again so they can really get it.
Inner City Blues, make me want to holler.
Inner City Blues. Thank you so much for being a part of the I Love Being a Girl podcast, where we minister to men and women. Have a great day, everybody.
Thank you.